Welcome back to EIR Talks. This is Tony Papert. It's Wednesday, April 7th, 1999. With us is Nancy Spanos, the editor of New Federalist Newspaper. Before the break, I had asked Nancy about the role of Zbigniew Brzezinski in landing us in this terrible blunder of a Balkans war, because Brzezinski's leading student, our unfortunate Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, was instrumental in changing the Rambouillet peace negotiations into a process that inevitably led to war. And Nancy has been reviewing EIR's file on Mad Zbigniew Brzezinski, President Carter's national security advisor.
Yes, last time we saw Brzezinski, I think people will think of him in the last days of the Carter administration, when he was ecstatic about the launching of war in Afghanistan, one also of the most devastating long-term no-win wars. And this was part of something he picked up from a British geopolitician, as he picks up most of his things, called the arc of crisis around the Soviet Union. And it was just a horrible way of trying to deal with the world situation. Of course, the Soviet Union was quite different from Russia today. They did have a world domination plan, but Brzezinski, having been tutored by William Yandell Elliott and a whole series of British geopoliticians, was approaching this from the standpoint of not any common national interests between peoples and nations in the world, but to try to inflame and create wars in the whole circle around the Soviet Union and play off China against Russia and essentially create a situation where the British geopoliticians would continue to dominate the through raw materials, financial flows, and prevent any kind of world peace. Now, Brzezinski, I don't know exactly what he's been doing in the last since 1980.
Very prominent in the media at this
but
moment.
Recently, he's made a big comeback. 1997 was really the beginning, I believe, when he wrote a book called The Grand Chessboard. There's a long subhead, too, something about geopolitical something. And this book was first actually picked up in Russia, because of its highly provocative nature, because he picked up effectively where he had left off in 1980, but now going after the Russian Republic and saying that we now have the opportunity in the United States to dominate the world with a one sole superpower. We can dominate Eurasia, which is the whole area from Europe all the way through China, and we can do this. We just have to make sure that Russia does not have an alliance with China. We have to make sure Russia does not have undue influence, he says, in Central Europe, which is have been the natural economic partners of Russia, particularly Germany. And then we also, he says, to do this, really make it easier for the Russians, he suggests that they break themselves up into three areas: Eastern Russia, Central Asia, and Far Asia. And then there's a lot of discussion in this book. All of these guys always have their hand in the till at the same time, discussing with oil companies, raw materials, cartels, and others how they can loot Russia, particularly in the Central Asia region. So in 1997, after he wrote this, the Russians, who already were quite alarmed at the impact of the IMF conditionalities on their country and saw behind that an attempt to destroy them as a nation, and were afraid that was from the United States as opposed to Britain, which it's actually from, said once again, you know, aha, here we are. You know, America's out to destroy us. Brzezinski's up front, and they were very sharp retorts. Now, since this time, Brzezinski has effectively been beating the drums for this. And you have to realize that this was written about a year after Madeleine Albright came into power in the State Department. I don't know direct connections between Gore and Brzezinski, but I strongly suspect that there are some, because Brzezinski, when we looked into him back in the 1970s, and we discovered was also a technotronic freak.
Right.
This guy puts together his geopolitical machinations with a belief that we have to have mind control through computers, and we didn't have the internet then, but if we had, I'm sure he would have included that, in order to supposedly get world peace,
right?
What this is reminiscent of is, again, the movie. One thing that I forgot to mention, not only the Freemasonry of Science, but also this idea of, well, how do you get peace? In their idea, and we didn't think to go through this, the pacification of the boss happens through the dropping of a peace gas, not any kind of rational coming to the idea of common interest, but a psychedelic experience. And in fact, this is the kind of thing that Brzezinski wrote about in his Technotronic Era book, which was written very closely in association with NATO back in the late 1960s. So this is what is behind and what is going on here. And when the Russians therefore respond to NATO's action in Yugoslavia by saying this isn't really about what they say it's about, this is about destroying Russia, they can point to chapter and verse effectively to show this is the case.
Right, right. So by declaring Russia the enemy, he's in effect making Russia into an enemy of the United States, or intending to do so, and vice versa.
And he then goes on TV and says, you know, no problem, ground troops, we can whip the Yugoslav army, don't worry about it, they're demoralized, speaking as the great Eastern European expert,
right,
when in fact he's been a long, long-term emigre from Poland. I don't think they want to claim him at all. And he's talking strictly from British geopolitics.
And like these others, I mean, frankly, he knows how to start a war, but he's not concerned with how to end one once it's started. So the responsible people are most responsible out front are Tony Blair for the British Empire, Madeleine Albright, whose role we discussed, very instrumental in bringing this war about, and Al Gore, who we discussed on previous shows. I mean, what is Gore's responsibility, as you see it, for this current war in the Balkans?
Well, I think we'd have to look at that in the in two ways. One is the what we went through last week on the show, which was his specific role in preventing Primakov from coming to the United States and finally having a meeting with President Clinton,
right,
and to be able to convince, to try to come to a modus vivendi, because if you wanted to stop genocide in the Balkans, you had to have a meeting between,
right,
the effective head of state in Russia and
Clinton,
the President of the United States. So you had a possibility under those circumstances,
right,
which otherwise was really not very clear. But in the longer term, Gore, as a representative of this kind of thinking of the British American Commonwealth grouping, with this kind of world vision that he has actually promoted in Iraq, Gore has been one of the,
right,
leading promoters of this technological apartheid against Iraq, has been the key person in the administration who's been promoting the destruction of Russia through the IMF, has been promoting anti-Primakov forces, particularly within the last 6 to 8 months,
right,
through his alliance with Chernomyrdin, and has been doing everything possible to prevent the kind of alliance between, an FDR-style alliance, between the United States and Russia to reverse the decline in relations and to reverse the economic decline. Gore's out to protect his godfathers. And,
right,
his godfathers, like George Soros, are totally tied into the speculative bubble, the raw materials control, and the outlook for a continuation of the British empire by other means,
right,
which is what is being pursued here in this war onslaught.
Now, EIR for years has called Slobodan Milosevic, the Serbian dictator, a Hitler, and has decried his ethnic cleansing, and has previously, of course, strongly supported the Clinton administration's moves to support the Croatians and the Bosnians against Serbia, which led to the Dayton Agreement. I mean, how can EIR and you and Lyndon LaRouche now oppose a NATO action against Serbia, which is supposed to prevent genocide in Kosovo?
Because it's not done to prevent genocide. Not only hasn't prevented genocide in the short term, it accelerated dramatically the genocide in the short term, but it has no intention or clear way of stopping the genocide. This is pure hypocrisy in every conceivable way, especially when it comes from Tony Blair.
Right.
Not that I'm saying that President Clinton wasn't potentially convinced that this was necessary, but even he has to have seen in the immediate period afterwards how what was done did not do, I mean, only accelerated
right.
the move toward the genocide. So the fact is that that this is an absolute fraud. And as LaRouche has pointed out, these people who are now weeping crocodile tears over genocide have seen it going on for years. They did absolutely nothing to stop it. It's been clear since the late 1989 that, in effect, you know, the British were supporting Milosevic
right.
and using him as a tool and promoting the Greater Serbia ethic, which has resulted in this genocide. The British and the French in particular, and some of the Dutch, were extremely strong in allowing him to continue this process
right.
before. And now, you know, when it serves the purpose of destroying the United States in particular, they all of a sudden are out front saying the genocide is the most important thing, even though what they're doing is actually doing nothing to stop the genocide. I think you pointed out just recently, the Pope also reflects this understanding. I'm sure there are many Americans who think, well, the Pope is just for peace at any price or
no.
something like that. But this is not true. He supported the bombing in Bosnia, where there was an Bosnian army on the ground that was fighting for its survival
right.
against this genocide.
He called for it well before, and obviously not in the words, give us bombing, but he called for it and strongly supported it.
But in this case, he doesn't see a just war, because what is being done is simply a ploy which results in more genocide and which is intended to create the conflict between NATO. It's intended to promote a new NATO doctrine that eliminates sovereignty, like the Freemasonry of Science, that creates a war with Russia, in effect,
right.
prevents the kind of solutions which are necessary on the ground. And you would have to ask, as Lyndon LaRouche has, if these people are so concerned about genocide, what are they saying about what's going on in Africa, where you have British Foreign Office sponsored wars, just who have already, over the course of from 1983 to now, killed an approximate 6 million people. What are they doing about Iraq, as you pointed out, where you have this whole generation of children being killed? And what are they doing about the International Monetary Fund, as in general? If you had to pick an agency which has been responsible for more genocide in the recent decades than any other force, you would have to say the International Monetary Fund. They are responsible for imposing the conditions that resulted in the breakdown of nations and the wars in Africa, that is resulting in the breakup and devastation of Indonesia, that has devastated the continent of Ibero-America. Again, like Africa, an incredibly rich continent in terms of population and raw materials and cultural resources.
Right.
This is what the IMF has done. But you don't find, you know, if you were to follow their logic,
they should be bombing the IMF.
They should be bombing the IMF. But of course, that's insane, right? You can see by that's not the approach to stopping genocide. The approach is a political approach to box in these lunatics, get them out of power, and put a viable solution in effect through the kind of proposals that LaRouche has put forward.
Right. I mean, I know You've mentioned it. I know you've been personally involved in the effort to save the children of Iraq from the effects of the embargo, technological apartheid, which is, it seems to me, much more important even than the bombing campaign. I mean, can you